Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for logging in for this fifth episode of the ICA Cricket Show, brought to you by the Indian Cricket Association. I am Satish Vishwanathan, your host for the day, and I take great pleasure in welcoming today's panelists, Sudha Shah, Nilima Joglekar, and Nushin Alkhada, all former Indian cricketers who will discuss the recent Indian Women's Tour of England and the way forward for this talented Indian team. Let me introduce our accomplished panels, starting with Sudha. Sudha, it's a pleasure having you with us. Your achievements speak for themselves.
Thanks.
21 tests, 13 ODIs, a former India captain. Sudha has also coached the Indian team for a long time and been a national selector. So, you know, multiple caps as usual. Welcome again, Sudha.
Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone.
Like Sudha, Nilima too has led India in one test, but, you know, she's played 20 ODIs, 5 tests, and part of the 1978 Women's World Cup. Currently a match referee, hoping to continue that, Sudha, now that the pandemic is, you know, causing disruption in the season. Will you still be match referee?
Hello.
Nilima?
Yeah. I don't know. 60 is the retirement age, but since we have asked BCCI to give us extension, because last 2 years, there was hardly any matches being played in India. So let's see what their take. We are ready. We can go on for 5 years more. So it's not a big deal. It would be a pleasure to serve women's cricket or cricket if I can.
What's the backdrop, Nilima, behind you? I see a lot of photographs around that.
Oh, yeah. They're all... there, my contemporaries and even newcomers or new age girls. And I just made it because I have this show in which this is just for a small group of Maharashtra cricketers that I made this group, and I interview the former players, and the show's name is New Innings with Nilu, Cricket and Beyond. And what they have been doing. And it was just for the pandemic that we were stuck in the house. And that was the idea behind getting all these group members together and to know about each other. So that was the idea. And I had this made because I do keep in touch with the latest of the latest. So whenever they are visiting Pune, or if they are playing in Pune, I make it a point to interact with the present day players as well. So it's like you can't keep away from cricket, and especially women's cricket. I'm a great fan of women's cricket.
Oh, brilliant. Well done. Now to the final member of our distinguished panel, Nushin, an off spinner who was once ranked number one all over the world. Thanks for joining us, Nushin. Nushin, can you hear us?
Yes, clearly.
Yeah. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
You're number one bowler in the world once. That must have made you a leading wicket taker at a point. So it must have felt very good at that point.
No, I had no clue about it. The person who we're sharing the screen with, Sudha Shah, she was the person who actually told me about that. Or back in 2003, we had no clue about these number one rankings and things. So when she, made us aware as bowlers that this was it, at that point of time also, yes, of course, but the job was just half done. So we had lots because we were planning our journey to the World Cup of 2005. And that was our focus at that time.
Sudha, was that the first time that some kind of rankings came in? What Nushin is saying is that they didn't know about it?
The thing is, I think it was only after BCCI took over and we came under ICC that the rankings started.
Okay. All right. Let's going on to the show. Welcome again, all of you. Sudha, I'd like to get to you first. Back in 2006, you were the coach on the Indian team. The women were in England. They lost the ODI series 0-4 then, but won the test series. I think two test series, they won it 1-0. They also won the first ever T20. So you have followed this tour. They do the volley test, but they've lost the two white ball series. What is your take on what happened in this tour? This current Indian that just got over last week.
The results were not as what we wanted it to be. But, if you take the positives, I think Shefali playing the innings in tests, which everyone thought that she's only a T20 player, and Sneh Rana's innings. And in a test match, I feel like Mithali and Harman are our mainstays. And, even after they didn't perform too well, the youngsters taking over, I think that was a big plus point in the test game. I think it was we thought that we'd lose, but they really fought back.
Yeah, Nilima here, again going back to the 2006 tour, I know India toured England past that also, but just because Sudha was coach then, I'm harping on that tour. The star performers were basically even then Mithali and Julian. And now I know in the batter's side, we've garnered some new talent. But does this extend to the bowling part also? Are we producing enough bowlers, you think?
In one of the matches, I remember Sudha has been there for all the matches, the iconic matches that India has played, because she has either played longest where her test career is concerned, and then it's even as a coach or donning all the hats of the selector. So she has been involved in all this, and credit to her for being with the game. And why I will say iconic, 2005 World Cup also, she was the coach of the team. So she has seen it all, you can say. And I feel that the bowlers, our strength is spinners, definitely. I'm saying this in spite of having Julan Goswami as one of our spearheads where bowling is concerned. But our spinners have done wonderfully well, may it be in India or abroad. So I think spinners need to be groomed and given leverage. Of course, we need, today's Ramesh Pawar, who's the coach of the team, he is insisting that we should have a pace bowlers camp. But yeah, I would say we should have bowlers camp, spinners especially, because we need to cultivate those bowlers and give them enough leverage, because they are the wicket takers. They are I won't be wrong by saying that the pacers, who is there after Mithali Raj? Julan Goswami. Julan Goswami has always been there, but that in your mind, it's always there. Who's going to be there? There are bowlers. Pooja Vastrakar is there. We've seen she's had health issues. She has, Mansi is one of them. She's again, we have not found anyone as consistent in the team. And that is where we should have some consistency where pace bowlers are concerned. Spinners are taking over. Dipti is coming in. Now Sneha Rana is also chipping in. So it's excellent to have these all-rounders playing their role. Even as a batsman in the test match just concluded, it was wonderful to see the whole team and especially the tail-enders chipping in. Otherwise, this match, it was a goner, but they believed in themselves. Especially, this was a fantastic comeback by Rana, and it was amazing to see. And spinners, yes, they should put in some more efforts, because we still need to have Nushin Al-Qadir coming in and bowling. We should not say that, okay, Nushin, you can go and bowl. We should have people coming in and taking their place in the team. Like these people, this iconic Neetu David and all these players, Dinadilji, all these players who were iconic bowlers, they should take their place in the side. That's all.
Yeah. Ramesh Pawar did talk about having expanding the pool of pacers. But the point you make, I want to take to Nushin. Nushin about the spinners. Sneha Rana actually impressed on this tour. She was on her debut as far as the test and ODI is concerned. What do you think overall of the current spin attack? And what about where does India's strength lie these days? Is it still spin, as Niliva says?
Frankly speaking, if you see the larger picture, yes, Sneha Rana's comeback into the Indian team was a delight. And the way she has, performed without any pressure, of course. But overall, I see there is a dip in the spin attack. Because there were times, I think, apart from Rajeshwari, I feel now, who is a little penetrative. Poonam has somewhere lost her way. Poonam Yadav.
Yeah.
Okay. Rita has to still get that kind of exposure to be in the one-day squad. Okay. And Deepthi, yes, of course. But if you see the past performance of Deepthi, not too far, 2017 World Cup, and now you compare, she's not been getting consistently getting wickets. So there is something, it is a concern. Also, we don't have the second strength. Where is where's the bench for spinners? If Radha is not around, Raja is not around, unfortunately, Rajeshwari was not there in the squad.
Yeah.
So we did struggle for a left-arm spinner. So we have not prepared our bench as yet. That is a concern. I think just not pace bowling where Ramesh Pawar, like he said, we need to have a pool of 10 to 15. I think we need to have a pool of 10 to 15 young spinners also. Not giving them an exposure directly in the Indian team, but grooming them. And we are known for a spin attack. There were times where medium pacers have gone for runs, but then the next 40 overs were controlled by the spinners. And it's been a legacy. It's been over the years it is happening. But we don't see that now. We're leaving too many runs.
Oh, so you're suggesting we have a spin camp too. Sudha, putting your coach's hat back on, what do we do? I mean, do we have enough women taking to spin these days? Or because there is a lot of thing, look at the men's cricket itself, fast bowlers, there also spinners are not that many. The fast bowlers are in plenty now in India. So it's just a cult kind of following maybe that's happening. Maybe more people want to take up pace. What do you think the scenario is in India right now?
I mean, I think, we keep saying the pandemic and these girls haven't been playing matches.
Yeah.
I think for bowlers, the more matches they play, the more consistent they become. And if you see these matches, our spinners were hit when they bowled short, our medium pacers and the spinners. They have to work on their line and length. And whatever talent we have, they need to work on their line and length. They have to be more accurate.
Yeah, I mean, I also agree with you that we should not wait too much on the results of the England tour. But there's a big difference in preparation. Our girls do not have that much of preparation before going into the series. Whereas England has played.
That the girls had to go through. I'm sure if it wasn't the pandemic, we would have had camps and they would have got into the rhythm. Yes, I mean, we need more talent. We need more bench strength. But I feel this time it was more that, the consistency wasn't there.
Okay. The other aspect, Sudha, that Ramesh Pawar, the coach, had talked about is the middle overs batting. I mean, he specifically because he's keeping the World Cup, next World Cup in mind, next year in New Zealand. So he was talking about the middle overs batting again being too dependent on Mithali. And of course, as you've seen, Harmanpreet slightly come back to form towards the later stages. Yesterday, she's got a brilliant 20-odd in the 100. The new tournament that England have launched. So what is your... I want to get all three of you in on this, actually. on this middle overs batting part? Is this something that we need to do? Is it a run scoring, a run rate issue? Is it, you know, a question of the tempo that he's talking about? What do you think this whole thing is about, and what do we need to do about it?
What I think is, like, our girls want to hit fours and not look for singles and twos. And in the domestic scenario, those shots they're able to get away with and they get fours, which is being stopped when they're playing international games.
Oh,
and
that's interesting.
So they're eating up more balls.
Okay.
They should be looking for more singles and twos than looking for the boundaries. I think they should work on that, right? Because that's what's happening in the middle overs. They're hitting, they're playing well, they're playing good shots, but then it's straight to the fielder and they're not playing with soft hands or, you know, trying to look out for the singles. They just want to hit those fours and sixes, which if they start looking out for the singles, the scoreboard will start ticking and the run rate also will go up.
Nilima, you agree with that?
I would put it in a different aspect as I see it, that the batsmen take any batsman. Now, we know Mithali is doing well, Smriti is doing well, and Shefali is doing well. But what is happening is, of course, they're not at all looking for runs. You know, Smriti hits one to the boundary and she's happy, like she's decided, okay, I'm going to get one run. They're not looking for runs, looking for that misfield, which can happen. So she's happy with one run. It goes with everyone. So they're not looking for runs. And another thing which is happening is all these players, great players, of course, but they are relying on one shot glory. Whereas Mithali, if you see the span of her batting, the V, I would say the V, okay, you play in the V, but even the horizontal bat shots, that V, you need to increase. You need to increase that. That means placing those shots. When you're saying increase the V, I'm saying where you can place that ball. Because Smriti, I will take Smriti getting out in one way. Shefali is getting out so many times to the back foot and she's trying to hit it over where she gets runs. No doubt about it. But they are not placing those shots good enough, well enough. If they're good in front foot drives, they should cultivate the horizontal bat shots also so that they cannot be caught in one position. They can feed them there where they're getting out or they're not able to score runs. So they have to find a way where they can stand. Now, instead of relying just on putting the bat, and one more definite thing that these people are not doing is using their feet. Absolutely no feet movement. Whereas we see, I don't know if it's a mental block or something with them. That's why mentally they should be very, very strong. And they should increase the number of strokes that they play on either side. I think that will give them leverage, what we are talking about, to rotate strike. If they have many more strokes to their scheme of work, then they will be able to. It's very easy to say they should look for runs, they should get the runs, but if they don't have the basic strokes, they cannot do it. They are relying too much on one stroke or two strokes. They should practice more about this, especially getting back and across. That is where we are losing out a lot. Back and across movement is not there. They are just going back, but back and across movement is not there. And whoever is doing well is doing that where rotation of strike is concerned. And they should always look for runs. They should not give up. Like they say, till the ball is dead, there is a possibility of a run, which they're not doing. They're saying, okay, I'm hitting one shot, but it is straight going into the hand, so I will get only one run. No, look for that misfield. Look for that placement. I think they will do wonders if every individual knows their role to play. I'm going to get 20 odd balls to play. I'm going to get 20 runs. How it's their vision, their thought. Of course, the coaches will help them come up with strokes or learning different things. But of course, they should have it in their heart to run. I'm sure that middle order can take care of itself if they're looking for runs. They are not looking for the runs, and rightly Sudha said that they are just looking for boundaries. Yes, it looks glorious, but still, now even if we see Virat Kohli playing, he gets those singles. They hardly ever hits those big fours. And same thing applies to these people also. If they have, they can do wonders if they apply themselves. Individual players apply themselves.
Good. Nushin, I want to take one point from what Nilima said. Actually, I want to ask you a question after that, a second one. The first one is using the feet. I mean, you're bowled to a lot of people in domestic cricket around Indian batters. So do you feel that that's not happening enough these days, that they're not using the feet that much as they used to perhaps when you were playing? Or do they use it more now? What is your take on this?
See, just to add on to what Sudha ma'am and Niluti have mentioned regarding the, you know, we said we don't have the lack of intent in our middle order. But if you see the larger picture about it, do we have the right people to play that role in the team? Okay. Sneha Rana, all her domestic season, she walks in as a number five batsman for the Indian Railways. So that's why you see a Sneha Rana performing there in the Indian team, because she is used to be playing in that situation. She can handle situation well. Now, what is happening is, if we look at the current Indian team, we have how many openers in the Indian team? We have a Priya Punia in the Indian team, which is an opener. Shefali, Smriti Mandana, Deepti Sharma herself. Richa Ghosh plays one down for Bengal. Harleen plays one down for Bengal. Where is the middle order? Tanya opens sometimes. So what justification are you holding on to these players for asking them to form a middle order when they don't play in the domestic? We need to have the right people. We need to get the right people. They're doing it. See, Mithali, if you see Harman and Mithali, they always walk in as number four, number five, or number three, or number four. So they used to be playing in that situation. This is one thing you need to deal with. The other thing about coming on to your question, Satish, you said using their feet. See, yes, batsmen do. I've seen Emily Drum using her feet, Hayley Tiffin using her feet. There are Belinda Clark. The biggest example was Karen Ralton. She was the most difficult batsman to bowl to because she used to even use her feet for a medium pacer, stepping out and hitting a medium pacer. We do have plans. But then, as Sudha ma'am rightly said, consistency in bowling. It's long hours of bowling to different batters. That's going to help. But I feel you should have the right people. Like, if you want a middle order, you need to have a middle order being placed there. You can't have an opener playing for your middle order there. That's why you see the Deepti Sharma strike rate is not good when she's walking in as a number six. She takes time to settle. But Rana doesn't take time to settle because Rana has been playing in that order for quite some time and she knows how to deal with it.
Yeah, that's a fair point, because you got to get used to your roles. You're playing at the highest level. So you got to prepare yourself at the lower levels, first class cricket. Completely point taken.
That's why exactly I said, what role are you going to play in the given team is very important. Even if domestic cricket, you may be going opening or this, but for Indian team, if you're selected, your role, you should realize it yourself and then go. And accordingly, it's very difficult for any coach to set a middle order if they're not middle order batters. Yeah, so it's
a very small time to work. See, especially knowing, you know, we are in pandemic from past 2 years, you know, a coach would not get time to work on. But yes, when you know that you are there, you yourself or a domestic coach can help the players. Because ideally now what I was impressed with was when I saw Richa Ghosh playing at Rajkot in the semifinals, she was walking in at the order what she used to play in the Indian team. That is a good sign. That means to say the coach is alert that I need to prepare this player for that slot because she's walking into the Indian team in that slot. This is what is needed. This has to be taken care of.
Sudha, I mean, I get their points, but as a coach, suppose you had two batters who are, you know, you would rank them, say, one who's far better than the other. You have these two people to choose from. But what happens to be an opening batsman, the other is a mid-order batsman. Well, you have a mid-order slot available. So would you pick the opening batsman and fit her into the mid-order as been happening now? Or would you say, no, I don't mind the lesser talented person, but she's more suitable for that position, so I will choose that person, the second person.
Basically, I mean, you make use of the team that you're given.
Very true.
And I mean, you have to tell the batters that this is your role. They can be, I mean, at that level, I can't say that I'm an opening batter, I'll only play like how an opening batter will play. I don't think that's fair. I have to sort of adjust.
Yeah.
And I mean, if you look at it, it's not that this was Dipti Sharma's first series. She has been playing for a few years and she's hardly open. She's not, she knows that with the Indian team, she's going to be at that, she'll be coming in at that slot. I think she should adjust. And she at that level, they should be adjusting and playing. You just can't say that, I mean, only opening. Yes, you do need those, you know, middle order batters. But if it happens to be an opener and going at that thing, they'll have to go with the mindset saying that they'll have to play strokes right from that, you know, right from the time they get to the crease. We can't say that, no, I'm an opening bat. I have to watch the ball for a while and then play. That's not right. I think at this level, you should be able to fit in where the team wants you to and perform accordingly.
Yeah. Nishin, would you tend to agree to that? I get your point that you got, but when you have a choice like this of somebody being more capable as a batter and then you're trying to fit her in, would you do that or would you say, no, I have to have a specialist at that?
See, as a coach, now it's important we understand what is the strength going to be and what is the winning combination for us. And likely, like Sudha ma'am said, that we need to adapt to the truly. I totally agree to it. But then, over the period of time, we see, like Dipti Sharma walking in as a middle order batsman, all right? But that is a wrong role for her to come back to domestic and start opening again. Because she's not improving her skills, is what I'm trying to say. Which I could see in Richard doing it. Of course, coming back to the thing, it is on a player's mind also that, you know, your role is, the coach has given you a role. That you're going to walk in two down or three down. So as a player, if I am representing the country, I need to adjust myself for that. And the coach is itself, and it's the coach's duty to make sure that the players are getting adequate chance in that position so that she or he has played enough in that role to understand different situations. So it is both ways.
Fair enough. You know, just on the same point of playing level, we have a question actually from Mana Dabi. She says, she's basically illusion. I mean, any of you can answer this. She says, when was the last time any of you saw four spinners in a T20 playing level in English conditions, especially? Apparently, she means that we played four spinners. I'm not sure of it, but has it happened that four spinners are a regular thing as far as Indian cricket is concerned?
Of course, yes, it has. It never knew. I remember
they opened the bowling attack. Yes.
I have been playing with one medium pacer and the other spinners.
And that too, not in a T20 format, but in a one-day format. I remember in 2003, when we were playing at Mumbai against New Zealand, I had opened one end and Amita Sharma opened from the other end.
So, Mana, you have your answer, Mana, you're listening to us. It happens in Indian thing because we are dependent on spin, as you said. I just want to now move from, you know, we've been talking about in this conversation about domestic cricket, saying what happens when we come back to play domestic cricket. And now, Sudha, they've announced, the BCCI has announced a restart of domestic cricket. Hopefully, we'll be able to get through the season. So we're going to have in September the women's 50-over games and followed by the challenger. Apparently, they are doing this so that they can then get a bigger pool of players in time for the World Cup and have a cap and all that before the next World Cup. So how do you see this domestic season progressing, Sudha?
I think one thing we should understand that cricket has to live with the pandemic now.
Very true. All of us have to live with it.
Pardon? All of us?
Yeah.
And we can't, I mean, it has been a long time, but I guess we have to be careful about it. And you have to give the girls opportunities. I mean, if you ask me, okay, this World Cup was postponed because of the World Cup, I mean, because of the pandemic. They should have already sort of looked at the final 15 by now. If they're still looking for players, you're not going to give them enough time to play that high-level cricket. I think that was a mistake because we should have already sort of looked at what our 15 is going to be for the World Cup. And not depend on this domestic tournament to decide on our 15.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I agree with Sudha that they should have started the planning before. Just not leave it till the last minute because we went far ahead in Australia where we reached the finals and then suddenly there was absolutely no planning, no nothing. Absolutely. You could have those players and there should be a lot of interaction between the coach, the captain and the selectors because they need to understand what point Nushin was trying to make, that we need certain amount of players in the middle order, certain amount of, and accordingly, if the team is chosen and it should have started now. If it hasn't started, just not let them wait for the domestic season to start. Now, after coming back from England, what are the girls doing? What is our team doing? They are practicing on their own if they get a chance. What are they doing? Are we really looking in to thinking that, okay, World Cup? Yes, we have that one agenda, World Cup, and we have the team ready. We have the bench strength ready. We have the second run team ready. And whenever they get a chance, play, give them opportunities to get them to play matches. Otherwise, they will never be prepared for the World Cup. If we keep waiting for domestic season to start, I hope it starts, but even then, no point waiting for it.
And to add here, like, even if the domestic matches start, it's mostly the openers who are getting opportunities and they get to score. Yes. And very few teams, the middle order gets to bat.
Absolutely.
And it's the openers in the top order that get the runs and you very, very few teams. And it's the lesser teams that the middle order gets to play. But the top teams, it's mostly the top order that gets to play. And we do... I mean, they don't get enough opportunities. And I feel like, I mean, take the 2005 World Cup. We started preparing from 2003.
Yes.
And we sort of stuck to the same 15, 16. And we gave them, you know, opportunities and that's where we performed. We can't think of, you know, making teams last minute and telling them to perform in the World Cup. Yeah. That's unfair for the player also.
Or we should have now in the given time, we should have more of challenger matches where there are 3-4 teams playing, only participating, 3 teams are participating. And then we get to see different combination and what works. So that will give the selectors opportunity to select the team, have the players themselves get opportunity to play, where Sudha rightly said that the domestic season may start, but it will have a very diluted effect on the players' skills where Indian team is concerned.
Well, I guess we have to wait for the monsoons to sort of get over before we actually start playing. But, you know, before the World Cup, Nushin, there's also this Australian tour where we're going to play again a test game, a test match and all that. So that brings us to the red ball aspect of it. This tournament, again, we're going to have domestic cricket. It's not going to be red ball. So how do we prepare for that?
In Australia, they're playing with a pink ball.
Mm. Yeah, correct. We're going to play a pink ball test. That's even more challenging.
See, one thing is that the World Cup getting postponed to next year is a blessing in disguise for us, because obviously 2020 was, you know, we were dealing with pandemic. And now we have enough game time, so we can prepare ourselves and, you know, get the domestic, sort out the loopholes and things. And rightly said that the preparation has to start now or never. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I feel that it is important that we stick around with a pool of 20 players, maneuver around them, get your combinations right, just in case, God forbidden, if you have an injury or, you know, because of the COVID, you're going to deal with a lot of other problems. And with this pink ball in, I think Shanta had suggested to BCCI for a challenger. Yes. Unfortunately, because as you said, monsoon, we wouldn't try to squeeze in. But what I have heard off late is that there is a Indian camp, which is going to be starting at the end of this month, which is going to be having a good fitness, good 10 days of fitness and then 10 days of skills. And they are going to fill in a pool of players to work on them. That's the only thing which we can do now. And NCA, because it's been monsoon everywhere. But yes, then this 20 or 25 should not be changed after your domestic. You can add on a player who's been consistent in domestic. But the whole idea is to stick on to these 20 or 25 players, work on them and motivate them that, you know, World Cup is it. Now we are preparing. That's how preparation is done. That's how we have prepared ourselves, no matter 2005 World Cup or 2009 World Cup or even the 2017 World Cup, you see, there wasn't too many changes. The pool of players were the same. So we need to work on them, have faith in them.
I completely agree with that. Nilima, there's one aspect of which I want to touch upon is the fitness. What Nushin just mentioned, that we're going to have a camp for 10 days. What is the current level of fitness of our players? Is it better than you know, earlier days, are we, especially, you know, we're even talking about mid-lows batting when talking about singles and all that. So has fitness risen to a good level now? Are we on par with the rest of the world? Are we on par with the men? What's it these days?
See, individually, they may be great players, but collectively, if we see the team, it's not fit. So fitness camp is the right thing to have because they have to rehabs are there, but now we have to look into the fitness part. They have to be 100% fit, all of them, no matter what. And I applaud that they are going to have fitness camp, because like Sudha said, 2005 preparation was superb. It was really good where they concentrated on fitness camps, and along with fitness, they should have skill practice and concentrated effort towards World Cup. I think there are a lot of players who need to have that concentrated effort where fitness is concerned. Definitely, it will help the team. We see Australia, England and New Zealand. We see Australia doing far better, and we see the fitness level of those players is superb. It's amazing. So we will get the results if our team is fit.
All right.
The fitness levels have gone up.
Yes.
But it has to be continuous. It's not that you have a fitness camp for 10 days.
Yeah.
And then when they go back home, they don't follow the same regimen. Yeah. When they come back for the next camp, it's again going back to square A. I feel, you know, they have a fitness camp, I mean, fitness regimen throughout. Like, you know, they have a two-day camp and they check their fitness level. They go back home. Mm-hmm. They have a camp after a month. And if that fitness level has come down, they're not considered. But with our players, when they go back, they're again starting from the, you know, not right from the bottom, but lower from what they were before. I think they should maintain their fitness regime. That's very important.
I think I will give credit to the present day players where they are doing all that online, they're getting online coaching where fitness is concerned. They are doing that. They're taking the efforts because again, now it's become a profession and they are they know the results that they're reaping. Now we see Sneha Rana. A few years back, she was not so fit, but now she has taken effort. So every individual is taking efforts. There are a few who may not be doing the same. Consistency, of course, should be there, but they are professional enough to understand. Now see, Harleen Deul, if you had seen her a few years back, it was difference between what she is today, and it's showing the results. So I would give credit to these players who are professionals, and they are putting in a lot of efforts on their own. So consistency will be maintained.
I'm a little surprised. Wouldn't the Indian support staff be giving these girls, you know, once the tour is over, giving them set targets, like you mean for the camp, you've got to have this kind of levels of fitness. You know, there are ways to measure these days. So hasn't it become more professionalized that way that they have to follow that?
Absolutely. I think in 2020, they had N number of online fitness classes where Naresh was taking care of it. He was, I think every week they were being monitored. So there is a lot of change, obviously, because of the current techniques and technology which has come in, which keeps us connected with a lot of things. And even they had a few mental toughness classes as well, is what I heard. So they have been monitored. But what happens again is... Once when you don't have any series coming up, then you're just left with your state camps. So that area needs to be taken care of, especially when you are in the scheme of things for the World Cup. Those players should be monitored. Those players' performance should be monitored at the domestic level, which is very important.
Okay. On that note, I think we've come to the end of our program. I mean, it was an absolute pleasure having all of you, discuss the whole thing. It's also good to see, yesterday, as we said, the 100 has kicked off, seen some of our girls there. So, we are spreading our wings more across the world. And I see, obviously, there's a huge potential, the future is ours to take. So, I just hope the girls rise to the occasion. As you people have advised, fitness is going to be key. So, they have to work on it individually too. Sudha, Nilima, Anushin, absolute pleasure having you three on board. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. And I'm sure the viewers, we had quite a few people watching this show. Thank you all for watching. I hope you all had a good time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.